Can you hear me? Hold on a second. Okay. Can you hear me? Can you hear me through your speaker?
Yeah.
Okay. So that's the, now I'm actually talking through my mic. I'm not on the phone anymore, but everyone else will actually have to be on the, will have to call in, I guess, in order to be able to hear me and hear the class. Okay. Shuaib and Khadija, you said no, sir. What are you saying no, sir, to? Oh, just follow the link. Okay. So you don't have to necessarily, I'm asking Shuaib because you're more familiar with this. Ah, so you don't have to call. So once I open this up and enable everything, you'll be able to hear me. Okay, great, because I was just having second thoughts about this. Okay, so everyone can hear me then? Okay, thank you, Shuaib. All right, because like I said, I was having second thoughts. All right, so, inshallah, enough time has been wasted trying to figure this thing out. And my apologies to everyone because this is my first time using DimDim. All right, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah rabbil alameen. Wa nawaitu ta'alamu wa ta'aleem wa tadhakir wa tadhkir. والنفع والانتفاع والإفادة والاستفادة وحفظ التمسك بكتاب الله وسنة رسوله والدعاء إلى الهدى ودلالة على خير وابتغاء وجه الله ومرضاته وكربه وثوابه سبحانه وتعالى والحمد لله رب العالمين. So first I want to say thank you all very much for coming to the class. Alhamdulillah. Inshallah, we are going to be studying the text of Safinat al-Najah, right? The ship to success, right? And there's a text that, mashallah, we studied. It was actually the second text in Shafi fiqh that we studied in Tareem. So, inshallah, we're going to try to follow along here. And hopefully everyone will be able to, everyone has a copy of the book, am I correct? Does everyone have a copy? Please say yes. Okay, alhamdulillah. Okay, so as I mentioned to you in the email, this text, and as you can see in the very first page, that was written by the translator of this text, that this text has been supplied to Sidi Jamal Adin Haisal for the purposes of his academic program. It is not to be distributed or passed out without express permission of the translator, who is a very dear friend of mine who studied with me in Tareem, Yemen. His name is Faiz Qureshi, and mashallah, is a very beautiful brother. This book was actually just published recently in England, and for that reason, and he's been gracious enough to allow us to have it for the purposes of our class. So please make a special dua for Faiz Qureshi and his family. Because that brother is just a very generous man, and he's just, mashallah, he's just a really wonderful person. And, you know, without him, we wouldn't have had this great translation, because it's probably one of the better ones of this text. And as we begin, we start out by saying, من يراد الله به خيرا يفقه في الدين. Okay? من يريد الله بِهِ خَيْرًا يُفَكَهُ فِي الدِّينِ. We say that when Allah wishes or wants goodness for his servant, one of his servants, he blesses that servant with knowledge. Yufekihu fiddin. He gives them understanding of what? Of deen. When we say fekihu, we come from one of the words of fiqh. And fiqh, as we know it, is a word that means what? Understanding. And so, as we're studying, what is it that we're trying to understand? The first thing we're trying to understand is how to develop our devotional worship to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is what we're trying to do. We're trying to not learn about a bunch of do's and don'ts. And trust me, as we start going through this text, and those of you who stay with me for the next text, because the intention, inshallah, after we finish this book, because we just, with a few students, we covered the Risalat al-Jami', which is the first text in Shafi Fiqh that we study in Dar al-Mustafa. And now we're studying the Safina, inshallah. And after which, we will move on to either the Muqaddima al-Hadramiyya, or I might just go straight to the Matan Abi Shuja', after which it'll either be the Yaqut al-Nafis, or we'll probably go straight to Umdat al-Salik, which is better known as Reliance of the Traveler. And we'll see what Allah has in store for us, inshallah. But as we're going through these books, we're not learning about the do's and don'ts. What we're trying to understand is how to develop and perfect our acts of devotion to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was asked why it was that he spent so much time in prayer to the point where his feet were swollen in the middle of the night, when he had been forgiven all his sins, and that he was guaranteed paradise. And his reply was, well, then should I not be a grateful servant? Meaning that we show our gratitude through worship. We show our thankfulness through worship. We show our devotion to Allah, our gratitude to Allah by the way that we worship. And we're thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because Allah gave us the gift of the Quran so that we could have a text or a manual as to how to find salvation, how to improve on being a good servant to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he gave us the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who helped us understand how to utilize this manual. He helped us understand how to perfect character. And he also showed us, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, how to be a human being and what the purpose of the human being is on this earth. And so through all of this, we're showing our gratitude and we're showing our thanks by worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We're also showing Allah that we're the ones who are in need. For Allah huwa, we say, Allah huwa samad. Right? When we say, Qul hu Allahu ahad, Allahu samad. Say that he is what? One. Or, as we like to say, he is unique. And one of the, and within his uniqueness, he's not in need of anything, yet everything is in need of him. And so that being the case, we are the ones that are in need of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, we also have to think about the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for whatever reason, has chosen those of us who are present today and those who will be present as we continue to go along. I mean, even for a moment, if Allah gives you a little bit of knowledge, then it shows that he has a concern for you. He wants what? Khair for you. He wants good for you. Just by giving you that inkling of knowledge, just a little bit, doesn't have to be a whole lot, doesn't have to be volumes of books. It can be one statement. And that one statement, if you practice it and you follow it to the hilt, that one little bit of knowledge can take you into paradise. Whereas you've got people who've studied volumes of books, but yet they still wind up falling short and find themselves in the hellfire. So don't make, as we should say, don't belittle or don't think less of someone who hasn't studied a great deal. If they studied a little bit and they're practicing that for which they know, they're doing more than most. You know? It's like they say that You know, Emmanuel Gazali says that if you throw a bucket of water on a rock, it just gets wet. But if you have a consistent drip on a stone, eventually it puts a hole in it. So for that person who has one book or has one little phrase to work with, but yet they're constantly working on it and developing themselves, and they're contemplating what was said, because through that contemplation becomes a vast amount of knowledge. You start seeing things that you didn't see before, and as a result, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blesses you with more. And then as you practice, you begin to gain more, you begin to understand more, i.e. you begin to learn more. So a little bit that you keep pushing and you keep treasuring that will open up so much more for you. As opposed to a person who just jumped in and learned and read all these different books and everything, but yet knows nothing. When I was in Syria, I remember a brother came in town, and all of a sudden he read three books, right? He read three books in fiqh and I think one other subject, and all these brothers, oh mashallah, he's so brilliant, oh mashallah, he read these books with the sheikh. But the thing about it is, if you went to him and you said, okay, now what do I do in this situation, that situation, this situation, if he has to say, oh well, let me go back and check my books, then what was the point? That's not the ilm. That's not true ilm. That's the acquisition of knowledge. Yeah, you sat with the sheikh and you read these books, but has anything stayed with you? And it's going to be difficult because you have to practice it. So inshallah, as we are taking on this text, as I said in our email, that the condition of this class is that you have to practice that for which you learn. The one surefire way to get this to stay with you, the one way to make sure that you're actually understanding this is by practicing it. This is what's important. This is important. So we want to make sure that as we are going through our text and everything we learn, again, we practice. Because when we say that, When we say man yuridu Allahu khayran yufaqihu fid din, what we're saying is that not only does Allah showing you that He wants good for you, He's also saying that there is also a type of hujjah being placed upon you. Not that when we say hujjah, we sometimes say a burden or a proof. And this is what I'm saying. This is something that once you learn, you have to practice. Because if you don't, you'll be called to question on the day of judgment. So we want to make sure to the best of our ability that we are practicing that for which we learn. Why? Because when we said that man yuridu Allah, or man yuridu Allahu bihi khayran, because Allah chose us to give us blessings, and because He chose to give us blessings, we have to do something with this ni'mah, with this gift. Okay? Is everyone hearing me okay? I'm understanding that the video is freezing a lot, but is everybody still able to hear me? Has the volume okay. Just want to make sure that everybody's able to follow me. There's no that there's no freezing. Shuaib and Khadija, he's saying that I guess for future reference, we shouldn't use the passcode. You just use your name to log in. Inshallah, hopefully, Shuaib, because this is the brother who recommended this, so I'm throwing this on you, Shuaib. But inshallah, Shuaib will be with me tomorrow. Hopefully, we can sit down and maybe get some good instructions so that we can pass them on to everybody, so that everybody has a really good experience while we're using this tool, inshallah. Because I really don't want to jump from tool to tool to tool to tool. because we had the same kind of problem with WizIQ that it frees up. And I have about maybe, I'm teaching and I've said about 30 minutes worth of material and then, you know, no one heard it. Okay. All right, so inshallah. I mean, we also have some brothers and sisters from across seas who are also participating. So that might be an issue. I'm not sure yet, but inshallah ta'ala. But of the haq, if you start having problems, please type them in. Okay? Tell you. Now, another thing we want to understand, in addition to what I've just said, so one, we talked about the book. Two, we talked about why we're studying. Why are we studying fiqh, right? And to whom are we studying? And whom are we worshiping? Which is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Venus is having problems. Okay. Well, we're going to look into this a little later. Okay. And Sister Samaya, she's saying that usually, Venus, if you have some headphones, try that and see if it works. If it doesn't, or if you don't have them, just let me know, and we're going to try and see what we can come up with. Okay. Now, Shuai, real quickly, if she calls in on the phone, do I need to call in on the phone too, or will she be able to hear what's going on? That's probably the biggest question. Okay. Well, Venus, if you can, if you're having a problem, if you can't use the headphones, please call the number. Let me know that you're going to do it, and I'll just call in, and then I'll just have the phone on speaker, and then we'll go on from there, inshallah. And then we'll try and work it out a little later, inshallah, ta'ala. Tell you. So we want to keep going. All right. So again, we said we want to make sure that we practice that for which you're learning, and that you also take your time to. As a student of knowledge, because every one of you at this point is a student of knowledge. It's not an issue, you know, a student of knowledge is not a person who just jumps on a plane and hits overseas and, you know, spends a lot of time, because, I mean, I've met a lot of people across seas, and the most they did was go to all the restaurants. So they probably can speak a little Arabic because they learned it in the street, and, you know, and they learned it at the restaurants. But when it comes down to some serious knowledge, they really don't have a whole lot. They may seem like it because they're speaking that Arabic and all that good stuff, but it's still, you know, we kind of get duped from time to time, thinking that people have knowledge just because they want to cross seas. Well, the reality is that whenever you sit down to study and learn something about this deen, about Allah's religion, then what are we doing? What have we become? We become what? Talib al-ilm. Why are you talib al-ilm? Because you're what? Seeking knowledge. I mean, that's what you're doing. You're looking, you're seeking knowledge. That's what a talib al-ilm is. Talib means to request, to seek, to search. Talib al what? Ilm, knowledge. And that's what we're looking for. And that's what we're trying to gain. Knowledge of what? Knowledge of Allah's religion. And we're going to define the word deen and so on and so forth as we go along. MashaAllah, tabarakAllah. So, that's the next thing. And someone else asked me now, what is a madhhab? Okay? Now, I want everybody to understand one thing. What we're studying is the Quran and the Sunnah. Okay? What we're studying, let me say that again. What we're studying is the Quran and the Sunnah according to the understanding of Imam Shafi'i and his contemporaries. We're talking about studying and learning from... I'm sorry. We're studying and understanding this deen based on the works of Imam Shafi'i, whose students... loved his work so much, his opinion so much, that they wrote everything down. And they kept his opinions. Now, one of the things that has to be understood, too, about this madhhab is that the madhhab at this particular point in time is not the madhhab of Imam Shafi'i, per se. Actually, the sayings that we follow and things of this nature come from Imamanawa and the things that he wrote based on one of the texts. Many people say when they try to say the Shafis don't have Dalil, well, they need to go check the Majmu' of Imam Nawawi, because that's where the majority of our opinions come from, as well as the Minhaj al-Talibin and other works such as these. Two scholars, Sheikh Ibn Hajar al-Haytami and Sheikh Muhammad al-Ramli, who were both students, and they studied together, but for certain reasons, they wound up splitting up and studying elsewhere. But these are the two major scholars in the Shafi school, and their differences come from areas where Imam an-Nawawi happened to be silent on a particular issue, or he wasn't very clear about what he was saying. And so from that perspective, you have different sayings, which we'll point out as we go along from time to time. Imam al-Ramli says this, or Ibn Hajar says that, right? And it's because they were studying the works of Imam an-Nawawi, right? It's not that often anymore that most people study the books like Al-Um or the Risala and things like that, unless you're studying Usul al-Fiqh, okay? But a madhhab, again, is a situation in which a particular scholar who's reached the level of being a mujtahid imam. So the question is, what is a mujtahid imam? A mujtahid imam is an imam whose level of knowledge, meaning that this person understands Islamic jurisprudence from the standpoint of Arabic, meaning his linguistical skills are very strong. We're not talking about just learning and understanding Nahu, grammar, or Sarf, etymology. We're talking about understanding, in addition to those two things, Balagha. Balagha, as some translate, as being rhetoric. In other words, this means we're talking about eloquence and language. Okay? It's a situation in which you understand the power in certain letters. That's why sometimes you find some verses of Quran to be very short, where you find some verses to be very long. And in many cases, sometimes the shorter verses are a lot more powerful than the longer verses, using certain words, right? Like, for instance, when we say, "Kalla sawfa ta'lamun," okay, now we translate that to mean, "Verily, you will know." But in actuality, that "Kalla," it's like saying you will absolutely, without an unequivocal doubt, know. I mean, it's a lot heavier. And then, unfortunately, English just can't encompass the heaviness and the depth of which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about when he's asking people about how they spent their time in this life. And he said, and you know, verily you shall know. I mean, he's saying, without doubt, you don't understand what you're about to get yourself into in an ebonical sense. Allah is letting us know that there's going to be something heavy coming down. And unfortunately, because we don't speak Arabic that well, or even those of us who do, many of us don't go on to study balagha, rhetoric, or eloquence in speech. And therefore, we never get to understand the true weight and the true power of the Quran in and of itself, or even in the hadith for that matter. So you have to have these three skills, and not just balagha. Balagha is broken up into al-ilm al-bayan and al-ilm al-ma'ana. Ilm al-bayan, right? The eloquence of the speech, and ilm al-ma'ana means the understanding of the true meanings behind certain words. Like, say for instance, we have when we say alhamdulillah, right? When we translate that, we translate that to mean all praises are for Allah. But the question is, where do we get the all from? Because we don't see kulul hamd. Right? To most of us, alif and lam just means the. And grammatically speaking, that means that the word can only end with a single vowel mark because it's a definite word. We know that it's a specific word, right? We're talking about something specific, right? We're talking about something, we're not talking about something that is that's just unknown. It's not nekira, it's ma'ruf, it's something that is known, right? So that's what we understand usually when we look at it from a grammatical standpoint, but from the standpoint of balagha and ilm al-ma'ana, right? We understand that aleph and lam means it's all encompassing. Right? It's all encompassing. So all praises. This is where the all comes from. That's why when we say as-salam, because now it's not just salam for peace or ar-Rahman, right? Merciful. The merciful, the all-merciful is what's contained in just two little letters. So when you understand nahwu, sarf, balagha, right? And not even just that, you also have to go and understand it from a literary standpoint, because there's specific words and phrases that come within a cultural context. So you have to understand, go as far as understanding literature. Right? They call it edib. Right? And as you go into literature, you begin to understand the language from a different perspective. So this is what we're talking about. So a mustahid imam has knowledge in all these areas. And that's just language. We haven't talked about understanding the Quran, understanding the hadith, right? And then looking at things from the standpoint of the usul, right? And how we're extracting understanding our rulings from Quran and Sunnah based upon the understanding of the Salaf themselves. Also understanding that Imam Abu Hanifa, Imam Malik, and Imam Shafi'i were all what of the Salaf, and Ahmed ibn Hanbal. We all know that, may Allah be pleased with them all, we all understand that all of these men were of the Salaf. And there were others. But for whatever reason, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose to preserve the works of these particular scholars. Now, so now the same with a mustahid imam is that his knowledge has gotten to a point where he can no longer follow another imam. He has to make his own rulings. And for Imam Shafi'i, his teacher was Imam Malik, who said for him to go and study and teach his own and make his own opinions because he had reached that level. And so as he went on and passed on, his works were passed on after his death, it came to a person, as we mentioned, Imam An-Nawawi, who is what we know him as, or what we call him as, a mushtahid fil madhhab, which means he's reached a very high level, but because of his humility and his desire to maintain himself within the Shafi school, he's not the type of mushtahid that goes out and makes his own madhhab. He stays as a very highly knowledgeable person within the Shafi school in and of itself. And there are others for other madhhab as well, but this was, like, for instance, in the Hanafi school, I know of the two that I know, which is Sheikh Muhammad al-Shaybani and Abu Yusuf Yaqub al-Ansari. Both of these men were contemporaries of Abu Hanifa. They were also known as his companions because they were always with him, and they were some of his first students. And it was actually Imam al-Ansari who actually started recording Abu Hanifa's works and he was actually the, in a way you could say, he's the founding father of that particular madhhab. Because, meaning, he was the one that wrote down all the works of Imam Abu Hanifa. So, mashallah for that. So, now, so as we talk about the mushtahid imam, and the mushtahid fil madhhab, this is what Imam An-Nawawi was. And so, we're reading the works based off of his brilliance, as well as Imam Ghazali in some cases, as the Risala to Jama'at was basically a book, a text based off of many of the works of Imam Ghazali, rahimahullah. Tayyib. So now we come to the Safina to Najah, which is a text that was written by one of the scholars in Yemen. And as we talk about the scholar, he is a distinguished, the judge and jurist, Sheikh Salim bin Abdullah bin Sa'd bin Sumer al-Hadrami al-Shafi'i. He's a, meaning when we say Al-Hadrami, it's like me saying Amriki, or someone saying Misri, or Inglisi, Inkeltari, meaning you're from England, Dominicani, if you're Dominican, Puerto Rican, if you're Puerto Rican, so on and so on and so on, right? because he comes from the village of, he comes from the valley of Hadramaut. And for most people, when you hear Hadramaut, most people think that Hadramaut is an actual like city. Hadramaut is a desert valley in the southern part of Yemen, and it's massive. And this is where like places like Tarim, Sayyum, Shibam, one of the oldest cities in the world is Shibam, is found there. Mokalla, Shihr, Inat. The place that is said to be where the burial, the resting place of Prophet Hud alayhi salam is also found in Hadramaut. So, it's a desert valley, and it is very hot there all year round. You know, it used to be funny because during like October, it's supposed to be the cold months, right? And I remember watching other students wearing gloves and having their scarves wrapped around their neck, and you know. And I'm burning up. I'm sweating. You know, and I open up the windows just to get some air, and they're shivering. Oh, who opened that window? I did, because I'm hot. But mashallah. But this is Hadramaut, and that's Shafi'i, which means that he studies and he understands the Quran and Sunnah according to the istinbat. And this is what we mean. Istinbat means understanding, right? According to the understanding of Imam Shafi'i. So if anybody were to ask you, well, what are you, brother? You Hanafi, you Maliki, you Shafi? No, I'm Muslim, but I follow the Quran and the Sunnah according to the istinbat, or the understanding of Imam Shafi'i and his but contemporaries. Because none of us are studying with Imam Shafi'i. You're studying with Jamaluddin, and I'm nobody. So the thing is that if someone is to ask you, what are you studying? You're studying fiqh. Okay, and they'll say to you, well, why are you studying fiqh? We weren't called to know madhab. We were called to study Quran and Sunnah. Well, that's what you're studying, Quran and Sunnah, according to the understanding of Imam Shafi'i, who took his understanding from Imam Malik, who took his understanding from the Sahaba themselves. So you're not going to get closer to the Salaf than that. We want to understand the Quran and the Sunnah according to the way of the Salaf, which is our goal. Well, then, you know, this is one of the ways to do it. And in my opinion, it's one of the better ways to do it. Tell you, Habib Salim was born in a village, Asbah, from amongst the villages of the valley of Hadramaut. He was raised and educated under the tutelage of his father, Sheikh Abdullah bin Sa'd bin Sumair, under whom he completed the Noble Quran and perfected his disciplines. Thereafter, he excelled in the art of recitation and hence was named Al-Mu'allim, right, the instructor. This being a Hadrami term applied to one working in the art of recitation of the Noble Quran and drawing from these prophetic traditions of Uthman bin Affan radiallahu anhu. The best of you are those who learn the Quran and teach it. As the same. He studied the legal disciplines from his father and a contingent of scholars from Hadramaut within the 13th century. Amongst them was Umar bin Saqaf bin Muhammad bin Umar bin Taha al-Safi, Umar bin Zain bin Sumait, and others. He propagated and taught the various disciplines, and students approached him from far and wide, taking their first sips from the spring of his knowledge. From the most prominent of his students was the Sayyid al-Habib Abdullah bin Taha al-Hadr al-Hadad and Sheikh Ali bin Umar Gauza. Thereafter, his son shone and his reputation traveled to the extent of poetry was comprised in praise of him by his peers such as Sheikh Abdullah bin Sheikh Abdullah Ahmed Basudan, who was really very famous in Tarim. It says, alongside his broad legal works, he partook in political affairs and was versed in munitions. He was commissioned to India to vet army experts in the field of defense for the Qatariya state. He also purchased various types of modern warfare munitions from Singapore and had them sent to Hadramaut. The treaty between the people of Yathi and Kathira, the Kathira state, was also administered under his guidance. So there was some people call it a confederacy or an alliance between
Yemen as well as India. And he was one of the people who actually set this alliance up. He said he was then elected as an advisor for Sultan Abdullah bin Muhsin, and there was no order effected except in consultation with Sheikh Salim. However, upon an altercation, Sultan Abdullah ceased referring to for consultation, and Sheikh Salim consequently traveled to India and then on to Java, where he took up residency. He was known to be from amongst the people of Probity, reciting the Book of Allah often, and Sheikh Ahmed al-Hadrami al-Maliki, or al-Mekki, mentioned that he would complete the recitation of Quran whilst going around the Kaaba, making circumambulations or tawaf around the Kaaba. It was in Bitala, from amongst the locals of Java, that death grasped him in the year of 1854, and he died having left behind them many works, one of which is the Safina to Najah, and may Allah have mercy upon him. As far as the Ford is concerned, you guys can read that on your own. I think I'm ready just to go ahead and just start getting into the text. And the Ford was written by both the two of my teachers, Habib Mashur bin Hafiz and Sheikh Omar Khatib, both of which are my are two of my very highly esteemed teachers. So, mashallah, yes. Okay, we'll go on. I'll be there in a minute. Be careful. That's another thing for those of you who are new with me. A lot of times my daughter likes to join in on the class, and so sometimes she'll see her popping in and out. So, I hope it won't be a distraction for you. No problem, Hamid. I'm just glad you were able to make it, inshallah. Tell you. We start out with saying Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, and as we start, and then I'm going to say this about the text. One of the things we're going to do in terms of how we approach this text is that we're going to study this text at the level of this text. So sometimes you will ask questions that are not within the scope of the book, and I may or may not answer, or I may answer the question to you privately versus publicly, because of the fact that I want to stay at the level of this particular book. This book is not all-encompassing, but it goes over a lot of stuff. So don't be too discouraged. And I will answer. I do try to answer all questions. So don't feel like I don't want to answer your questions, and don't feel like shy to ask questions. But I definitely want to teach at the level of this text, and I intend to go through this text basically almost word for word. So we're going to be in this book for a while, and having classes every Tuesday and Thursday for an hour, inshallah ta'ala, we will probably go through this book. We're probably finished with this book in maybe October, maybe sooner. Those of you on the conference call, can you hear me? Can you hear me okay? Okay, good. Alright, so we start out with Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Now, can anybody tell me, yes, we will continue, is my wish to continue through Ramadan. Now, unless all the students say to themselves, well, we don't want to continue through Ramadan, and that's your choice, then inshallah we'll stop the class and pick up after Ramadan. But it's my feeling that we should continue through Ramadan. The only thing that will be different is that we'll make the class a little earlier. We'll have it, instead of 8 to 9, we'll have it from 7 to 8. That way you still have enough time to, well, for those of us here, the people in the Dominican Republic, you have Maghrib around 7:30, I think. But here in the United States, our Maghrib doesn't come in till like almost 9 o'clock.
Okay.
So, inshallah, we'll try and work it out. We'll try and make some accommodations for everybody so nobody misses out. But I personally would like to continue the class through Ramadan. And if anybody has objections to that, please don't hesitate to let me know. I mean, I understand we're starting right now, and this is Sha'ban, and Ramadan is coming up, and people want to spend time with their family and reflection and things like that. No problem. No problem. but I would like to try to continue on if possible. And yes, the classes are being recorded.
Okay.
So, inshallah ta'ala, we'll try to be able to maintain things. And we have a brother here who's in Sydney. So, okay, so as well to dhuhr for you. La ilaha illallah. Well, inshallah, we'll try and, like I said, we'll try and make some accommodations. As we get closer, let's have, you know, we'll have some more discussions and we'll be able to pinpoint what we're going to do, inshallah. Anyways, starting out with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Can anyone tell me why we say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim? Now, most of you who were with me before, you should know. Okay, one person says, it's what the Quran begins with, right? We seek the help of Allah, right? And Tariq says, any important work without it is cut off. Hamid, to begin with the name of Allah and to associate our actions with His glorified name. To connect action with Barakah, right? Okay, Zarif can answer any time. You don't have to tell me that he's going to. Just go ahead and let him answer, inshallah. And then you can say this is Zarif at the end. So, the first thing, when we talk about Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, okay, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, as has been stated, and everybody for the most part is correct, but let's make it a little bit more specific. When we say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, first, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam, he said in a hadith that has been graded by Imam An-Nawawi as being a sound hadith, as being hasan, or being an okay hadith, he said, Kullu amrin dhibala la yabda'u bismillah, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim fahuwa aqta. He said that any action of significance that is done without saying Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim is cut. We'll say it again. Any action of significance, meaning anything that you're doing, that, you know, any serious thing that you're doing, that begin and that is done without you saying Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim is cut. Cut from what? Cut from the barakah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's what it means. So any action you do without saying Bismillah, you're removing yourself from the barakah, or that action from receiving the barakah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when we say Bismillah, because we translate, this all makes sense as we go through this. When we say Bismillah, what we're saying, as we break the word down, we look at the ba. The ba in Bismillah, we would say grammatically, is harf jar. It's a preposition. So Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim is a prepositional phrase. But that's not enough. We need to go deeper than that. Here, the ba, it actually means musahib ma'a tabarak. It means to associate something with barakah, with blessings. Is everybody with me? So when we say, alhamdulillah, when we say the bat and bismi, right? The bismi. When we say bismi, that bat, it means to associate something with barakah. So what do we associate? We say bismi. So we're saying the bis, the ism. So we're saying we're associating the name or a name, right? And we know ism is that for which you call it, as they define it in Arabic, right? Or in Arabic, they define it specifically as mushtaqqan ma'a sammu, right? So that for which is attached to or connected to that for which you call it. In other words, a name is like if I say, you know, ball. Ball is, okay, we know this is a ball, so that's a ball. So what's the name of that thing? Ball. So that's what it's tied to. That name is like associated to this item. So we're associating a name, and what name are we associating with Baraka? Ismullah. Okay, so now when we say Bismillah, okay, and when we talk about Allah, we say Allah is ilm al-wajib al-wujud. Okay, ilm ala that al-wajib al-wujud. Excuse me, ilm ala that al-wajib al-wujud. Right, meaning is having knowledge upon the essence of the necessary being. What do we mean by that? Having knowledge upon the essence of the necessary being. In other words, we know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by his attributes. And we say that it is important, or it is Allah has to exist. Right? It is the Islamic belief system that Allah exists. Well, we take it a little further, saying that Allah has to exist. And why? Because if Allah does not exist, then none of us exist either. Because our station in this life is a station of what we call majazi. Meaning, we're only permitted to be here. We're only permitted to be in existence because of Allah saying, kun fayakun, be and he is. Be and it is, excuse me. So that being the case, and by us, by the fact that we are in need of Allah, that's what majazi also means, is that we're here by the permission of Allah, which indicates that we're in need of Allah. And because we need Allah, Allah has to be al-wajib al-wujud. He has to be, or it is obligatory, it's a must that his existence be true. Because why? If it weren't, then we wouldn't be here. And we say understanding the essence of Allah. Well, we can't truly understand the essence of Allah, but what we do understand is that we understand who Allah is by way of his attributes, because that's what he has given us to know him by. He's given us, like as many of us like to call them, the 99 names. These are his attributes, and this is how we understand who Allah is. We understand how magnificent Allah is. Like we were talking earlier about the Aleph and Lam, and how with the Aleph and Lam, we utilize this Aleph and Lam to help understand the all-encompassing aspect of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Like just this past weekend, we were having a discussion about saying assalamu alaikum to people. For instance, when you say assalamu alaikum, when you put the Aleph and Lam there, you're talking about Allah's peace versus Salam Alaikum. Where when you say Salam Alaikum, you're just talking about peace. Peace be upon you. But Assalamu Alaikum means Allah's peace be upon you. So that Aleph and Lam means all-encompassing, which means it's an attribute or it's attributed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, when we say Bismillah, it means that we're associating an action with the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then we go into what? Two of his attributes, saying Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. And when we say Ar-Rahman, we're talking about a ni'mah al-'am, right? We're talking about a general blessing. Right, as many of the scholars say, that this blessing, this mercy, is for all of mankind. Mercy, Allah's mercy, is for everybody. You see all kinds of people getting rich, drug dealers, politicians, generals, people in the military, everybody's just getting rich off of other people, off the poverty of other people. You see all these people doing wrong things and corrupt and being corrupt. But this is from Allah in a sense. Now, in a sense, this is a form of Allah's mercy. That He's given them an opportunity to have these things. They're just choosing to do wrong with the things that they've been given. That's the difference. But just like a person has eyes and arms and ears and feet and toes, these are all given to us as a rahmah. And then we've been given the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that he's a what? A rahmah lil alameen. Right? He was sent as a mercy to what? All of mankind. Not just a certain select group of people that call themselves Muslim. He was sent to everybody. That's why this deen is so diverse, because this religion is for everybody. And the message of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is universal. It's for everyone. That's the important thing. It's for everyone. Now, so, if we say that,
it's 9 o'clock.
We know that this mercy stands for everybody. But however, the Rahim, which we say it is a ni'ma daqa'iq, right? Or daqiqa. We say it's the small, more intricate blessings. Okay, these are the little nuances of Allah's mercy. Meaning, many of us, as we say, have eyes. From Allah's rahmah, we have eyes, we have arms, we have fingers, we have legs. But the reality is that not everybody has the ability to utilize sight. You have eyes, but you can't see. You have ears, but you can't hear. You've got arms, but you can't use them. You got legs, but you can't use them. You got toes, can't use them. Those people who are able to utilize these things, this is what we see from Allah's what? Rahim. And this is why also, many of the ulama, they say that since the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was sent to all of mankind as a rahmah, that only those who have listened to, adhered to, and went to the call of that message of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam will receive Allah's rahim in the afterlife. Meaning that rahim is being able to enter paradise. Or that you may enter hellfire but be pulled out. That's still a part of Allah's rahmah, don't get me wrong. But the ulama, many of the scholars say that this is something, the rahim is something specific for those who have accepted Islam and moved where? In towards and have gone into paradise or have gone into hellfire, that rahim is what is going to help us get in. And Allah knows best about that. Tell you. Is everybody with me? Okay. Any questions here? Feel free to ask a question. Go ahead and type your question in. Can you hear me right now? MashaAllah. Okay. The two imams under Imam An-Nawawi, who came after him to study his works. Okay, good. I'm glad everybody can hear. Is Ibn Hajar al-Haytami. And he was also the one who wrote the Book of Enormities, you know, the major sins. Ibn Hajar al-Haytami. And Imam Muhammad Ramli. Alright, so again, Sheikh Ibn Hajar al-Haytami and Sheikh Muhammad al-Ramli. Okay, now I was talking about in Balagha, ilm al-bayan. Ilm al-bayan is how one speaks. You know, they say that the person with the most powerful speech is the one who uses the fewest words. The person who has to use a lot of words is the man who has the problem truly articulating his beliefs, his understanding of a subject, or better yet, his understanding of language. So, ilm al-bayan teaches one how to, it shows you one, the power and the strength in utilizing words to the point where you're only utilizing shorter sentences. So that's the ilm al-bayan in a nutshell. That's kind of like a high-level overview of ilm al-bayan. It teaches you how to shorten up your sentences, but yet make them very, very, very powerful. And you find dozens of them throughout the Quran. Inshallah, if you remind me next class on Tuesday, inshallah, I'll give you some examples from a text that I have. Now, I hope that answers your question. And another thing, if at any time you feel as though I'm not thoroughly explaining something, or you still feel you're still unclear about something I'm saying, please tell me. I have no problem telling you I don't know, and I will definitely find out an answer for you, whatever your question is. If I can't answer it, I will give it to you by the next class. If, in fact, I explain something, but yet it still seems vague, go ahead and tell me, and I will try my best, and tell me what it is you don't understand, and I'll do my best to make sure that I explain it in a way that you're able to understand. Because let's remember, you're not here for me. I'm here for you. So it's my job to make sure you understand this material and understand these things, and for me to teach you the way it was taught to me by my teachers, so that you can understand the way that, you know, it's been passed down over the centuries. And if I'm not doing my job, then I need to know it. So I'm very open to criticism. I'm very open to your questions. So don't ever feel shy. And as Omar ibn Khattab said, that, you know, knowledge begins with a question. So if you really want to know something, you know, feel free to ask your questions. And don't feel shy about it, inshallah. Tell you. So, inshallah, we're gonna end here. You can ask the questions, fine. But as far as what we're taking, we're gonna end here, because the next thing we need to talk about is we've explained what Bismillah ar-Rahman means, right? And hopefully you understand why now we say that when you say Bismillah, you're actually attaching Allah's name to an action that you're doing. And the barakah that we receive from the action comes from the fact that we're associating Allah's name to that action. Okay? So now that we've talked about that, and that's why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, any action of significance that is done without saying Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim is cut, right? Cut from the barakah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because it wasn't done with His name. So that being said, inshallah ta'ala, the next thing we have to talk about is, well, what are the actions? What actions are we talking about? And the ulama have summed up the actions of the human being into five categories, of which is also affectionately known as the Ahkam al-Shar'i, right? The rulings of the Sharia. And we're going to talk about that, about what Sharia is and all that good stuff, inshallah ta'ala, on the next class, inshallah, on Tuesday. Tell you. So the question is it safe to say that the Ar-Rahim is exclusive to the Muslim and or Mu'min, or to anyone that received the message from the Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Right? The Rahim is specific to anybody who is considered a believer. Anyone who has followed and taken on the path of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Does that mean that Christians have the ability to also have this Rahim? Well, the golden rule is, if the Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that I will not punish the people until I send them a messenger. If these people have never heard of Islam, never heard of the name of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and never have heard of the message of Islam, then they're going to be judged on a different set of criteria. However, if they have heard of them and they have rejected faith, well, that's what makes someone a kafir. And I want to make that clear. We don't call people kafirs just because they're not Muslim. A person who is a kafir by definition is one who has rejected belief. Now, many people, like my neighbors and the people walking out here, even some of my family members, they've never heard of Islam. They don't even know anything about this religion. So they don't know anything to reject anything. So we can't say that these people, we can't just automatically start calling them kafirs. You know, so we have to be careful of that kind of thing. You know, and some of us who don't have Muslim families, or like grandmothers and grandfathers and people who raised us, well, are you willing to call them a kafir? Look, mom, you a kafir. Astaghfirullah. Don't call your mom a kafir. But, you know, teach us on, I guess. But that's something we need to understand as well. All right. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. How can we get this recording for listening and reviewing before the next class? Inshallah, I'm going to discuss that with Shirei tomorrow, inshallah. And inshallah, once I find out how I can extract the recordings, or if there's a link that I can send out to you guys, I'll send you an email over the weekend. So if you like, you can go back and listen to the class as many times as you want, inshallah ta'ala. And we'll see. Be of Allah. Tell you. So anyways, hope I haven't bored you. I hope at least out of some of this introduction, inshallah, you've gotten something. May Allah reward you for even being here and just listening to me. Hopefully, inshallah, you'll all come back to the next class on Tuesday, inshallah ta'ala, because we've got a long journey ahead of us, and inshallah, it'll be a good one, and a beneficial one for me and for you as well, inshallah. So please keep me and my family in your dua, as I will keep you all in mind, and hopefully, inshallah, bismillah, we'll see each other on Tuesday. اللهم أعطنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وأعطنا عذاب النار اللهم أعين على ذكرك وشكرك وحسن عبادتك ربنا تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم وتوب إلينا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم اللهم اغفر لنا ذنوبنا فإنه لا يغفر الذنوب إلا أنت اللهم ادخلنا الجنة اللهم إنا نسألك رضاك والجنة ونعوذ بك من سخطك والنار اللهم إنا نسألك توبة قبل الموت وشهادة عند الموت ومغفرة بعد الموت وعفا عند حساب وأمانة من عذاب ونصيب من الجنة وارزقنا إلى نظرة إلى وجهك الكريم وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعليه وصحبه وسلم سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين طيب. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته وإياكم.